luxury vehicles have different flavors about them, and a lot of that relates to where the vehicles originate, for example, Germany. But even within the same region, automakers can have different approaches to luxury. So today we're going to find out what flavor Audi, through its 21 Q5, brings to the table. The 21 model year Q5 is a refresh, so Audi is gussying up this vehicle's exterior with a new grille. Still got that octagonal shape, but now we've got these chrome slats and it's larger. And horizontally, we have these gray painted inserts. Redesigned LED headlights is standard with optionally available matrix LED headlights. That's on this vehicle right here. Redesigned lower bumper with no ventilation here, but we do have LED fog lights. And then this alu optic treatment for the lower front face. It's like a silver, but it's painted and it's exciting. Let's move to the side. Now you're gonna get updated 18 and 20 inch wheel designs for the 21 model year. 19s are gonna be standard on the prestige equipped Q5 that we have here, but this one has upgraded 20 inch wheels with this 5-arm design. Looks pretty darn good. Coming to the back, we've got the same alu optic treatment for the window trim and the roof rails. And then at the rear, we have a roof mounted subtle spoiler there. Alu optic treatment across the tailgate to kind of bring it in line with the Q7, the larger Q7. Updated LED taillights here, and that same alu optic treatment is for this diffuser, and we can see there are no exhaust ports. This Q5 right here is painted in the optional Navara Blue Metallic. It's a gorgeous paint color, especially when that sun hits it. Overall, the updates to the Q5's exterior keep it sharp and exciting in this compact luxury SUV space. Under the hood of the Q5 45 designation, we get a 2.0-liter turbocharged four-cylinder that now has 13 more horsepower than before for a total of 261 horsepower and 273 pound-feet of torque, connected to a 7-speed dual-clutch automatic gearbox and all-wheel drive system as standard. We get 0 to 60 time of 5.7 seconds. Fuel economy is going to be 23 city, 28 highway, and 25 combined. If you want some plug-in hybrid action, they'll add an electric motor to this for a total of 362 horsepower. We get to 60 in just 5 seconds with that one. 27 combined MPG. MPGe is rated at 50, and it gets 19 miles of all-electric range. Inside the Q5, to contrast that Navara blue metallic exterior, we've got Atlas beige for our interior with these really nice gray accents and contrast stitching. That looks excellent. I'm not such a fan of the high gloss wood trim, however. It just looks a little cheap, along with a lot of piano black for this part here that's gonna smudge and scratch as they always do. This is the prestige trim. So we have a bevy of additional features in addition to standard goodies like heated front seats, a 3-zone climate control system, and new for 2021, wireless smartphone charging and parking sensors, and a 10.1 inch infotainment that frankly looks a little tacked on, but it does run the latest version of Audi's MMI software and it's super quick. The graphics are so sharp, user-friendly. It doesn't have additional controller down here, but you do have a physical volume knob and seat control and mute button. In addition to those standard features, the Prestige brings with it Audi's virtual cockpit system that, again, like the infotainment, has a new version that's so crystal clear, so sharp. This is really probably the best iteration of a digital gauge cluster across the market. On top of that, we've got a head-up display, then we've got heated steering wheel controls, parking assistance features, we've got a Bang & Olufsen 3D sound system here, memory for the driver's front seat, and cooling in addition to heating for these front seats, heated rear seats, a panoramic glass sunroof. There are also heated and cooled front cup holders. On this infotainment, we've got navigation and a 360-degree camera system. Speaking of camera systems and safety, as standard, you're gonna get blind spot monitoring with rear cross-traffic alert and those parking sensors I mentioned, along with automatic emergency braking. Add to that for the Prestige, we've got adaptive cruise control with traffic jam assist and a lane keep assist function in addition to the lane departure warning that comes as standard. So to recap here, the layout is fine, the trim is not my favorite, and the infotainment and virtual cockpit are huge wins as part of all the extras you get with Prestige. Hopping in the back, the doors open nice and wide to make it easy to get in, and when you're in, this is my driving position at 6 feet tall. We can see I've got some knee room here. The footwells are nice and tall, so I can slide my feet forward. I've got headroom here, not a lot of it, but just enough. And the Prestige also brings with it these manual sunshades here. So if you've got kiddos, they're not gonna get sun in their eyes in the back. We also have those heated seats I mentioned, along with two USB ports. They're USB-A's, not USB-C's. Now you can slide these seats forward 60-40 split. I am in the furthest back position. If you needed more cargo space, you could slide it forward, and they do recline. Not really all that far, but just a bit. Now if you did need a seat 5 across, let's see how that works. Well, it looks like you can fit as a full-size adult. Knee room is gonna be fine. The only problem here is in the footwells, there are these humps here for these front seats, so your feet are gonna have to be kind of bowed out and therefore taking up some of the room of these passengers on your left and right. This is not gonna be a good solution for three adults wide in this back row. When you open up the trunk, I first appreciate how high the tailgate goes, so taller folks are not going to be hitting their head on it very often. In the back here, we'll have 26 cubic feet of space, and if you need more space, you can just pull on these tabs right here, and it's a convenient way to lower the seats. You then have to go in and lock them into place, and they're not fully flat, they're at just a slight angle, but you do have 54 cubic feet of space then. And now under here is not additional space, it's just going to be your space saver spare tire. You can vary up the driving experience in the Audi Q5 via the drive mode. So right now we're in comfort mode, but there's also an auto mode, dynamic, and individual. Individual is where you can go in and fine tune how you want the steering resistance and your throttle response and your shift timing. And then dynamic is, as you might suggest, sharper in every regard. Right now we are in comfort, so we're just cruising along, and I find that the ride quality in the Q5 is very, very good. There is some firmness in the undulation, but when you go over bumps, you don't feel it in your bottom, and that's a big deal if you're daily driving the Q5. It's also very quiet in this cabin. I'm not getting much wind or road noise at all. The only thing you do hear is when you get on it with that engine and it wakes up, it does make a bit of noise like it's working hard. But that's okay. It's kind of to be expected if you're really hammering it on the throttle. Speaking of getting on it, when you go into dynamic mode and then you really give it to it, taking a corner, the all-wheel drive system works really, really well. Quattro has been around for a while. They've refined it. They get the power down and they give you the confidence as a driver to get that grip. And of course, if you live in inclement weather, the confidence to get through things like ice and snow. And there is a healthy amount of power at your disposal here. You can also do your own shifting with these paddles on the steering wheel. And the responsiveness of that 7-speed dual clutch transmission is pretty good. The shifts are quick, and it'll let you hold it out almost all the way to red line, and then it's going to shift for you. It won't let you bang off the red limiter or anything like that, but it's still a fun to drive SUV. And now here we are on the highway, take it out of the dynamic setting, get back into maybe auto mode. And let's see here, how does it cruise? Well, there's a bit more wind noise that comes in at freeway speeds, but that should be pretty evident in any vehicle, and the visibility I find to be pretty darn good. There's a tiny blind spot over in that C-pillar, but you can rely on all those other safety features that you have a standard, like blind spot monitoring, to keep you out of trouble. We also have adaptive cruise control and lane keeping assist in this vehicle, and both of those systems work very, very well, especially with the Prestige model. We've got the traffic jam assist, and now it's time to consider how the Q5 stacks up to its rivals. So this Q5 45 model starts at $44,395. However, as tested in Prestige with a couple other standalone options, this one's just under $57,000, and that is a chunk of change, but let's consider what else you can get. And I am going to consider all the all-wheel drive versions of the Q5's competitors, because the Q5 does have all-wheel drive as standard. So the BMW X3 xDrive 30i starts at just over $46,000, so a bit more expensive than the Q5, and it makes 248 horsepower, so less power than this. The 0-60 time is going to be more at 6.2 seconds, and the fuel economy is going to be slightly better at 27 combined mpg. Cargo space will also be just 2 cubic feet better than the Q5 45. We also have the Mercedes-Benz GLC 300 4MATIC. That's starting similar price to the BMW X3 at $46,000 and some change, and it's going to make 255 horsepower, so just a bit less than the Q5. Its 0-60 time is going to be a little slower at 6.1 seconds. The fuel economy is going to be 1 mpg off at 24 combined mpg, and the cargo space will be a bit less than the Q5. And then we have the Porsche Macan, and that's going to be the smallest vehicle in the segment with the least amount of cargo space. It is going to make 248 horsepower, so less than the Q5. The 0-60 time is going to be slower at 6.3 seconds, and the fuel economy is going to be the worst at 21 combined mpg. So with all of those competitors laid out there, we can see that the Audi Q5 stacks up really, really well. It is the cheapest to start, it makes the most power of the set, and has some of the higher fuel economy and cargo space ratings. We get back to our original premise now. What is the flavor of Audi communicated through this Q5? Well, I think it's edgy, I think it's begging for a second look, and I think it deserves it. If you want to learn more about the vehicles I mentioned here, go ahead and click the link in the description below or go to automakers.com. Thank you guys so much for watching.